Dear colleagues, it's a privilege for me to speak on this outstanding conference on a special topic which is direct matter of our concern in my country, but related to the yesterday discussion and today topics, is of course it's quite understandable for us that the main topic for the discussion is the influence of foreign precedents, case law on the adjudication in countries who, first of all, who are the members of the Council of Europe, who shares common, common values, and similar approaches to the understanding of basic values, principles, and the content on human rights. So, is this question how foreign precedents and the case law of Strasbourg operate in the domestic legal system? A foreign precedents debate lingers in national legal doctrine for decades, often spilling over to court rooms, parliamentary deliberations, political discourses. Case law of foreign courts and international tribunals frequently pops up, both overtly and judicial decisions are covertly in court deliberations. The effect of comparative law approaches is felt both on national and international levels, thus making explicit what is termed as judicial dialogue. Every time we are talking about judicial dialogue, this is not only, this is a two-way highway. Jurisprudence of international courts and tribunals inevitably refers to national systems, to borrow process and indoctrinate legal principles, concepts, ideas, and approaches, while national systems recourse to international jurisprudence to legitimize legal policy choices, reinforces the process of legal cross-fertilization. As was encapsulated in doctrine, the development of choices reinforces the process of legal cross, the development of supranational legal system as EU law, as well as international courts and tribunals, as ECHR, ICC, etc., has inescapably brought up the need to legitimize legal argumentation in judgments and decisions through recourse to national legal systems, their approaches, concepts, methods, thus opening the fathomless floodgates of comparative legal conceptions, borrowing analogies and common principles. This highway operates not only between international and national judiciary, but also between different national legal systems. We recognize the mutual influence our neighbor legal systems, like Ukrainian, Lithuanian, Latvian, Hungarian, and this is a horizontal level of exchange views with our jurisdictions. In the same manner, national judges scrupulously look at their counterparts in international bench as forefronts of transnational legal discourse and transitional legal developments. In this respect, references to international case law relates not so much to the status of or relationship of a national court to an international court or tribunal, but to need to keep up with the development of law and legitimize counter-majoritarian interpretive control of judges over constitutional law content as guardians of constitutional principles and values. Recognizing the dignity and authority of other decision makers may add to judges' legitimacy within their own legal order or confer it to on others. As rightly Tom Ginsburg said, this tension is particularly apparent where constitutionalism is safeguarded through a judicial review. Our government body, unelected by the people, tells an elected body that its will is incompatible with the fundamental aspirations of the people. This is the main problem in our constitutional court adjudication, not only, I guess, not only in Ukraine, but in other countries, especially who still had some kind of Soviet or post-Soviet legacy, because the concept of law is a formalistic, positivistic concept. Law is the will of the people, and no law then higher than the will of the people through the representative in the parliament. This is the main destiny of our courts, how to restrict this will. in the parliament, first of all. Of course, in Ukraine, Ukrainian people, of course, introduced the changes to the constitution with a constitutional complaint started from the October this year. It's fundamental development of my country. It means that, of course, it's not full constitutional complaint like in Germany, but it's normative complaint only on laws, statutes which adopted by the parliament. But of course, we may develop several techniques how to operate smoothly. I mean the question of formal compatibility, but divergence in the interpretation or by law, by judiciary, because the obligatory requirement for constitutional complaint to the constitutional court is the final judicial decision in the particular case. And only in this case we may open the proceedings. It means that we can look at the how the laws, provisions of some laws interpreted by ordinary courts, and we make judgments and motivation related to this interpretation, that it would be sometimes not coincide with the substantive values and provisions, implicit and explicit provisions of the our constitution. So when we are talking about, I would like to talk in general context first, and then particular on the case law of Strasbourg. The major part of the comparative constitutional law discipline is focused on how and why judges opt to recourse to foreign international case law. In the academic discourse, three modes of comparative adjudication has been distilled through analyzing the treatment given certain foreign decisions. The first universalist mode is premised upon the ancient idea of transcendental universal principles applicable across jurisdictions. Probably it's a tradition of natural law, or in the word, I accept this liberal concept of understanding on fundamental human rights and freedoms. A second, dialogist mode is used to contrast and discuss foreign precedents against national judicial approaches and thus sharpen and improve the national court's reasoning. Just to borrow good examples of decisions from all jurisdictions. It's not so easy for our courts because the states didn't ratify some kind of treaty for the acceptance of such reasoning of foreign courts. It's a matter of, as I told yesterday, matter of reasonable judge. Reasonable judge has discovered what his or her colleagues doing in other jurisdictions and apply the ideas in hidden or an open way. It depends on the tradition. And the third one, legitimist mode. Most relevant for constitutional adjudication, means recourse to foreign international authority to legitimize constitutionally permissible choices made by a national court to tackle jurisprudential or policy problems. Why it's most relevant? Because especially Ukraine is not in vacuum. Ukraine is a context of European integration and the system of the Council of Europe. And from this perspective, the interpretation our constitution through case law of Strasbourg court or direct application of case law in our judgments is crucial for to legitimize our decisions in the broad public and of course in the not only political circles but for broad academicians, for advocates, for all Ukrainians, that we are doing right work and we develop in the right direction. But if we analyze the case law of Strasbourg, it's some kind of, in my opinion, it's some kind of concentrating ideas of constitutional law from domestic jurisdiction, not only from Europe, but also from the US and Canada. That's why we have to be open for this development. But in Ukraine, Ukrainian case could be seen as a clear exemplification of such tendencies. Ukrainian constitution doesn't contain any supremacy clause for international law. The idea embedded in the Ukrainian constitution is premised on the concept that international instruments ratified by the parliament shall be part of national legislation, standing above laws but inferior to the constitution. No recognition of international precedents can be inferred from the constitutional text. In certain respects, such situation is part of Soviet legacy that is quite suspicious toward international law, especially international precedents as emanated from and affected by predominantly bourgeois legal system. Bourgeois is in Marxist ideology, bourgeoisie, it means not like bourgeois, like citizenship, but bourgeois is quite negative reaction of Western society during Cold War. This is the term. So the path of international precedent and constitutional jurisprudence of Ukraine was not so much straightforward. Yes, of course, we have some kind of phenomena of constitutional smuggling. This is a specific smuggling, I mean, hidden borrowing of ideas, not in direct terms. This is specifically the case in Ukraine in the first decade of constitutional adjudication. At the down era of the constitutional court, foreign international precedents popped up in courtrooms and decisions rooms, debates, but never in the judgment reasoning. What the constitutional court dared to do was to make references to international legal instruments. Legal instruments, first of all, it's international norms, but not precedents. International treaties, etc. Nevertheless, such foreign transplants as political question doctrine, Ukrainian equivalent political expediency, purposeful interpretation, proportionality, legitimate expectations, new property rights, etc., entered the constitutional case law from the back and door. The clear example of such smuggling is a decision of the Constitutional Court of Ukraine in December 1999 of the unconstitutionality of death penalty in Ukraine. And when I was scholarly advisor to the just reporter who we were preparing the draft, and it's a clear example that some kind of suspicious attitude to the case law of Strasbourg in 1999 still existing, because we proposed in the text direct citation of a very well-known case, Söring versus UK, for the violation of Article 3. The death penalty clearly violates Article 3. Everyone understands this case. And we proposed to cite this precedent in the decision, but colleagues, judges just crossed it out, this one, and put in the text the word that the incompatibility death penalty with the Article 28 of Constitution, but Article 3 of the Convention, recognize the European Court of Human Rights. Of course, for me it's understandable that it's a certain case, but for our other readers, not so clear. But afterwards, I would like to mention the case we decided last year, when only recently explicit reference to ECHR case law to support the court's position have started to appear in the court reasoning. The Constitutional Court judgment in the administrative offences appeal case rendered in April last year became the apex of such adjudication, whereas it was in the case that the court explicitly worded the human rights restriction test based on ECHR case three-tier approach, European Union fundamental chapter on human rights, and by constitutional smuggling, as I mentioned, Supreme Court of Canada and Latvian and Lithuanian Constitutional Court jurisprudence. The court this time, unlike instance in previous cases where the ECHR practice was encouraged, made one step further. It formulated the general juridical test for assessing legislative restriction on constitutional rights. The problem is that no provisions, such provisions in the constitutional text. It was proposed in 1995, just before adoption of our constitution, 1996, that we need to clear, specify what the criteria of legislative restriction on fundamental human rights and freedoms, but again, it was simply crossed out from the text because of the concept of understanding the law. The law, in particular constitutional law, is black letter law. It's every constitutional, it means everything that in the text, no other, no principles, no values, no unwritten ideas. So, we formulated such criteria. According to the Constitution of Ukraine, restriction of the right on appeal and cassation may be allowed. However, it may not be arbitrary or unjust. Such restriction shall be established by the Constitution and laws of Ukraine. Pursue legitimate aim, there shall be social need in attaining such legitimate aim, it shall be proportional and justified. In restricting the right to appeal judicial decision, the legislator shall introduce such legal regulation which allows optimal attainment of legitimate aim with minimal interference with the right to judicial protection, it shall not infringe the very essence of this right. So this is a general test which now is possible to put on all laws which are restricting the fundamental constitutional rights and freedoms in our constitution. And of course, it's through the borrowing and through the use and experience of European Court of Human Rights and other courts, we formulated this test generally from the substantive analysis. Because in this case particular, it was the case for the when the legislator prohibited the right to appeal a cassation on administrative fines. Administrative fines, but for all fines, only enough the decision of the first instance court. And the Constitution, Article 129, it was clear wording of the Constitution that exceptions would be possible according to laws. And my colleagues told me, oh, please look, this is the example that legislator made the exception. Has made the exception on this case. It means that everything constitutional, because it's a clear wording of the Constitution. Constitution allows exceptions, but I propose as a judge reporter to go to vent opposite direction, to introduce such substantive analysis, and also using the not only social need, but our need of our legal system to harmonize our practice with the ECHR. This convention and its application through case law, because you know that the, of course, Article 7, Protocol 7, Article 2 to the convention in the criminal offences, obligatory to have the appellation. And through the third criteria, severity of punishment, we put it in the text. It means that big amount of administrative fine is without appellation is a clear violation of the convention, and we cannot close eyes on this situation. That's why we discovered it and we put on the motivation and decided that this is unproportional, and violate the right to court according to our constitution, because all fines in one bag. Yes? And from this perspective, a quite interesting development afterwards, when we changed when the constitution was changed, new changes to constitution has occurred, and starting from October, as I mentioned. Through this judgment, the related changes happened, and now in all cases, the appeal procedure is obligatory for all cases. So you see that the influence direct to the constitutional text. Through when the our case law, I call it case law, directly has influence on the constitutional text through the changes. And some words, I have 3 minutes or five, yes?
Yes.
And some words about our last development, very interesting development for the direct recognition of case law of Strasbourg as a part of our constitutional law in the process of interpretation of constitutional provisions. It was happened in June 1st, this year. In the case, in the decision of our court on conformity to the constitution of Ukraine, constitutionality of the provision of Article 13 of the law on psychiatric care, it's so-called the case on judicial control over hospitalization of legally incapable persons to psychiatric institution. We discovered in this case that we have Article 29 of our constitution, right? The part first of this article, the same as the name of the Article 5 of the convention. The person has the right to liberty and personal security. But other parts of this Article 29 talking about criminal proceedings, criminal and administrative arrests. No other places of no liberty, no other places. It was the question how to interpret this first part of the Article 29 through other parts of this article, or through the case law of Strasbourg Court, because Article 5 recognized and the case law, other places of where the person deprived his liberty. And psychiatric institutions also the place of detention. Detention of a sound mind, lawful detention of sound mind person. And we started with the statement of how we understand the right to liberty in the broad sense. It's just case law. We just educate people what does it mean liberty. Because what we are talking about, constitution first of all, it's liberty. It's liberty first. And we tell directly in the decision that the Constitutional Court of Ukraine proceeds from the fact that among fundamental values of effective constitutional democracy is freedom, the presence of which the person is a prerequisite for its development and socialization. The right to liberty is inherent in an inalienable constitutional right of the individual and assumes possibility of a choice of his behavior with the goal of free and comprehensive development, to act independently according to his own decisions and plans, to prioritize, to do whatever is not prohibited by law, freely and at their discretion, to travel through the country, to elect a place of residence and the like. Right to liberty means that man is free in its activities from outside interference, except for the limitations established by the Constitution and laws of Ukraine. Afterwards, we start to interpret article first part of Article 29 through the case law and the text of Article 5 of the Convention, and we formulate first in our jurisprudence the principle of friendly treatment of international law. Just a citation. The Constitutional Court of Ukraine takes account of the requirements of the effective international treaties ratified by the Verkhovna Rada of Ukraine and the practice of interpretation and application of these treaties by international bodies, which jurisdiction is recognized by Ukraine, including the European Court of Human Rights. Since Article 29 of the Constitution of Ukraine corresponds to Article 5 of the Convention for the Protection of Human Rights and Fundamental Freedoms, then according to the principle of friendly treatment of international law, the practice of interpretation and application of the said article of the Convention by the European Court of Human Rights should be taken into account when considering this case. And afterwards, when we cite in the criteria of Winterberg versus Netherlands and Groshkov versus Ukraine, we extend habeas corpus right of part 4, Article 5, and of course Article 29 of our Constitution of all places of deprivation of liberty. Not only psychiatric, in this case, institutions, but probably something new is possible discovering in the nearest future. For example, new place of detention is a block post. In English, block post, something like on the line of border control.
Administrative border control.
But in the zone of anti-terrorist operation, and just not ordinary border control like in Vilnius airport. But it's something different. Yes, I understand. So it's a more broad application. And also we fixed the idea of positive obligations of the state in this case to care about some detention facilities to fulfill the obligations of the state. If we cite the case Stork versus Germany about private psychiatric institutions. So it's a clear example. Afterwards, we decided that to declare unconstitutional such provisions of the law, which are psychiatric care concerning hospitalization to psychiatric institution of the person declared to be legally incapable at the request or with the consent of guardian upon the decision of psychiatrist without judicial control. It means this law, it was possible to apply law, statute, to put person in the psychiatric institution without judicial control, just omission of legislation. And of course our judges in general jurisdiction cannot be so open-minded to the understanding of basic values and concepts. My understanding, this is the role of constitutional court in my system, because for them it's of course according to the law. We have special law on enforcement of the decisions of European Court of Human Rights and application of case law in our system. It was special statute adopted by the parliament. It's quite interesting development. Only a few countries have such a special law how to enforce judgments of ECHR. But we are on the first place on the amount of applications and probably on the first place of non-enforcement of the decision. This is a clear example when the law statute cannot cope with the problem, because the main idea of the problem, not laws, but understanding mentality of judges. First of all, not only all community, of course, but judges, most responsible to fill up these vessels, which I mentioned yesterday, with new understanding of law and human rights. And of course, and we continue such idea of friendly treatment towards international law in the case of public religious public meetings. And according to law of Ukraine, on freedom of conscience. It was adopted in 1991, just after breaking out, after Belovezhsko-Pushcha agreement. Yesterday we celebrated 35 years. And it was adopted that is still valid law that for religious public meetings, they need to obtain permission. Instead of prior notification, as it mentioned in Article 39 of our Constitution, for all Article 39 of our Constitution is related to freedom of associations and peaceful meetings. And we told in the decision, mentioned these principles, also mentioned this principle, cite this principle, friendly treatment, and say that public religious meetings, as according to the also case law of the Strasbourg, Brankevich versus Russia, is the same public meetings, but only religious character. It's the same meetings, peaceful meetings. And that's why we decided this unconstitutional to have permission. So in the final, sorry, it's quite extensive, but to be in line with the schedule. From 1999, as I mentioned, the case of constitutional court on death penalty abolishment, when we cited case law in hidden way. Now, when we our last case law expressively stated that absolutely clear for us, using the principle of friendly treatment to the international law, that we interpret constitutional provisions on human rights in line with the well-established case law of Strasbourg. Well-established case law, I understand as a continental concept, jurisprudence constant, yes? It means that the case law, well-established case law of Strasbourg, is a part of our constitutional law in the interpretation. So this drastic development comes to the good end, and I hope that after introduction of this new instrument as a constitutional complaint, the docket of the Strasbourg court will be below the such high quantity. But our main idea is not to work to help the European Court of Human Rights, but of course we respect the European Court of Human Rights. First of all, if we have constitutional rights, the same nature as rights in the convention, they have to be defended through our legal system, first of all, through general jurisdiction, and finally through the Constitutional Court of Ukraine. Thank you for your attention. Thank you.